All right. How's that? Can everyone hear me now? Does everyone have audio now? Check 1, 2. Awesome. Sweet. Sorry about that, everyone. All right. So we're going to go back and I'll start over now. So welcome to the investing webinar, the best investing strategies. As I mentioned, thank you to everyone who posted questions in the forum. I know some of you were having some technical difficulties, and so we're working on those, and those should be fixed soon. So I've got about 5 or 6 questions from the forum, and as I go, just ask any and all questions in the chat box, and I'll either answer them as I go or at the end. And as I mentioned, you know, you can ask anything that you want about investing, and you can literally invest in anything. And I sent out a video, I put a video in the forums in the members area about 1.5 weeks ago, short video on investing as kind of a preview for this longer event. And we really started with this idea of short versus long-term investing. And so that's really how you should split your investing strategies. It's money you're gonna need in 5 years or less, and money you're gonna need 5 years or after. In my opinion, a lot of people are too conservative with their short-term investments. I always myself knew, because I was gonna make more money, that I didn't have to keep much money in cash. You know, often experts advise that you keep, you know, between 3 and 6 months within an emergency fund. I think that that's only really good advice for people who are just starting out. Depending upon how much money you have and how much money you have saved and how much money you're making in your full-time job, as you become more of an experienced investor and you've got a good career and a good side hustle, or you know, you're confident in your money making ability, one of the worst things that you can do is actually keep too much of your money in cash on the sidelines, because if you know you're going to make more money, an emergency really is a relative term. And so throughout my FI journey, really I had 3 to 6 months expenses saved for about the first few months, but I realized that I didn't want to keep that money on the sideline. And so really at any given time, I only had between $5,000 and $10,000 of cash that was readily accessible, and the rest of it I was investing for the long term. So it's important to be honest with yourself about when you're actually going to need the money. And so, you know, if you're going to buy a house in the next couple of years and you're saving up for a down payment and you're like 99% certain that you're going to buy a house, you know, that's one area where, you know, you're not going to want to take too much risk with the money. But with an emergency fund, if you're worried about, you know, a catastrophe, you know, be cautious about how much money you keep on the side, because a lot of people that I've talked to, you know, they've got $20,000 saved in a savings account, and that's really their nest egg. And that's the nest egg that should be growing, not should just be sitting in a savings account. So at the end of the day, it comes down to how much, you know, how comfortable you are with risk. I've always been quite comfortable with risk. And as I said, because you can always go and make more money. And even in an emergency, you know, if you've got good credit, you've got a good credit card, you pay off your balance, you know, you can use some of that credit as a swing factor. So really determining your short versus long-term investing strategy, it's something that, you know, you're going to get more comfortable with over time. I do know a few of you are keeping a lot of money in cash just because stocks are really expensive, but really thinking, when are you going to need the money? If you need it in 5 years or less, you want to put it somewhere more conservative, like an online savings account. Ally has a really good one that pays, I think, 1.78%. So at least you can keep up with inflation. You know, you can open a certificate of deposit. You can put it in a bond fund that doesn't have withdrawal penalties. And so really being honest with yourself, as I said, about when you're going to need the money. And from my personal perspective, you know, I always knew that if I got in a huge pinch, you know, I was going to be making more money, and so I could put it on my credit card and then pay down my credit card, because I really wanted to maximize my stock investing. And like I said, it just, depending upon how long you've been investing and getting comfortable ultimately with that amount of risk. And then really, as you know, investing is a long game. So, you know, you want to think about investing really for the rest of your life. And there's money that once you invest it, say in a 401k or an IRA, you want to consider that money gone for the immediate future, and just, you know, don't even think about it in a sense, you know, because you're investing for such a long term. And really, at the end of the day, a lot of investing, the best investors in the world, you know, the Warren Buffetts and others, the reason they're so good is because they control their emotions. And so the more comfortable that you get with investing, the easier it is to not be emotional. When I first started investing, you know, I was buying a lot of different stocks and they would go up and down in value. I remember one day just sitting in my office looking at my phone, being so stressed out because this stock that I had bought a couple days before had dropped like 30% in value. I ended up freaking out by the end of the week. I sold it. I lost about 40% of my money. And if I would have just held on to that stock over the next year or two, it actually ended up tripling in value. And so it's one of those things where you're going to get more comfortable with risk the more time that you spend with your money. And the more time that you spend with your money, the better investor you're going to become. And you're going to get a sense for how much money you actually need to have laying around. So at any given time, even now, you know, I never have more than like $10,000 or $15,000 cash available at any time because I want to keep my money in the market and working as hard as possible for me. There are some challenges, and we'll talk a little bit about them. There were some questions about the fact that stocks are so expensive right now, and we'll get into that in the stock section of the investing strategy. So now I want to talk about stocks. And the first thing I want to talk about is, you know, you want to always win where you can win. And so a lot of people leave money on the table because they don't use the accounts that they have access to in the right way. And so tax optimization, you know, while it sounds, you know, nerdy or maybe really boring, it's actually pretty simple and it's really important. And so, you know, how you use, you know, your 401k account, your IRAs, you know, the other investment accounts that you have available to you will make a massive difference in how much money you have down the road. You know, a lot of people, you know, they reach out to me and they ask, you know, how should I invest my first $1,000, my first $5,000? A lot of them, you know, go and put money right into Betterment or to a wealth front instead of taking advantage of the tax advantages of their 401k. And so if you work for a company that has a 401k and you're offered a match, you know, some companies will give you a percentage of your salary. If you contribute that much to your 401k, you should always be contributing enough to get that match no matter what. There's, you know, if you're listening to this video, you know, you're probably one of those people who's already getting the match. But if you're not, you need to take advantage of that immediately. It's 100% free money. You're never going to get a better return than that. So always contribute enough to your 401k to get the match. And then after you get the match, it becomes a little bit more complicated what you should do. So whether you're investing in your 401k or an IRA, in some cases, if you're making less than, you know, around $75,000, the next best decision after investing in, you know, in your 401k to get the match is actually to open and invest in a Roth IRA. So the Roth IRA is like the most incredible retirement account that's available in the United States, essentially because your money grows tax-free, you know, really just into the future. So you're able to, you pay tax on the money before, so you're not able to deduct that money from your income, but the money goes tax-free and you actually get to withdraw it tax-free in the future. Timothy asks, if we're striving for FI by 35 or 40, wouldn't the early withdrawal penalty be detrimental to that goal? That's a good question. So there are restrictions with Roth IRAs that you actually, there's a penalty, a 10% penalty that gets, you know, you get penalized if you take the money out before you're 59 and a half. But there's some important ways and easy ways to get around that. So first off, the 10% withdrawal penalty is only on the gains. And so you can actually always take out the money that you put into a Roth IRA penalty free. The money that you've put in, you can actually take it out at any time in the future. You know, if you run into a hardship, you know, what gets subject to the early withdrawal penalty is only the growth of your investment, not the money that you previously put in. And so I think that's an important note. And the other thing is there's something known as a Roth IRA conversion ladder. And a Roth IRA conversion ladder is this secret hidden in the tax code, Timothy. You know, you might know about it, maybe you don't, where you're actually able to convert your traditional IRA into a Roth IRA, and then you're able to take that money out 5 years to the day of that conversion, completely penalty free. And so, you know, if you're trying to be FI by 35 or 40, what you want to do is about 5 years before of it. 5 years before, you want to start converting, you know, your 401k into a traditional IRA, and then your traditional IRA into a Roth IRA. The conversion between a traditional and a Roth IRA is a taxable event, and so you want to be careful just to minimize the amount of taxes that you're paying. But if you do it intelligently, just starting 5 years before you decide to use that money from your Roth, you can start that conversion, and then you don't have to pay the 10% early withdrawal penalty. So that's one thing that, you know, a lot of early retirees are able to use to minimize that early that penalty. But back to the fact that, you know, a Roth and a traditional, there's Roth and there's traditional 401ks, and there's Roth and there's traditional IRAs. A Roth is in most cases, if you're making $72,000 or less, it's going to be the best decision for you because of the tax advantage. The fact that your money is going to grow tax-free over the long term is such a huge advantage. If you're making, I believe it's somewhere between 70, I don't know the exact numbers, but it's somewhere between $72,000 and like $110,000, then you can actually, you know, you can't contribute to a Roth IRA because you make too much money, but you can contribute to a traditional IRA and actually take the tax deduction. And so you can contribute to it and take the tax deduction. And so basically, no matter, you know, how much you contribute to it, you're able to reduce, you know, from the amount of your income that is taxed. And then what you can actually do, and if you make over a certain amount, I think it's like $125,000 or more, you're not able to take that deduction. But what I've always done, really from the beginning of investing, is, you know, I made too much money to contribute to a Roth, but you can do that conversion. That it's called a backdoor Roth IRA conversion. You can do that conversion essentially tax-free as long as you don't have any money, other money in a traditional IRA. So I never have. So every year in January, I contribute, you know, $5,500 to a traditional IRA, and then I immediately convert it into a Roth IRA. And so it's basically like I'm still able to invest in a Roth IRA, not pay taxes. I can't deduct that from my taxes, but that money that's growing, that's in my Roth IRA now, can go, you know, grow tax-free well into the future. And so, you know, getting back to the idea that tax optimization is so important. And so you want to invest in your 401k to get the match. That's a no-brainer. It's 100% return on your money. And then after that, you want to open a Roth IRA if you make under $72,000. Max out your Roth IRA up to $5,500 per year. And then if you've done that, then go back into your 401k and then try to max it out. And so between the two, I believe the 401k contribution limit is $18,500 right now this year, and the Roth IRA contribution limit is $5,500. So you can save $24,000 in those two accounts. And in most cases, you know, if you're making under $72,000, that's $24,000 of your income that doesn't get taxed. And that's the incredible benefit, because you don't have to pay taxes on it. So it's reduced the amount of money you need to pay tax. And then that money, you have more money that's going to grow and compound over time. So don't just go take $2,000 or $3,000 and, you know, buy a stock or, you know, put it into a Betterment account. Put as much money as you can into those tax deferred accounts, like 401ks, like your IRAs. And then if you're able to max out both of them, so $24,000 a year, then if you have a side hustle, You can open up what's known as an SEP IRA or solo 401k, and you can actually put even more money in. So every year, you know, for, if you own your own business, if you have a side hustle, you can actually put over $50,000 in another retirement account, further reducing the amount of money that you're paying taxes. And so really from an investing standpoint, when you're investing in stocks, you want to pay as little tax as possible by taking advantage of those tax advantaged accounts. And as I said, in almost all cases, if you're making under $72,000, the Roth is the right choice. If you're trying to retire early and you make too much money, then investing in a traditional IRA that you can then convert later, Timothy, you know, and others is a really good decision. Number two, risk asset allocation and early retirement. And so there's a chart after this slide, and I'll make sure that you have these slides to download in the members area underneath this video. You basically, if I'm still, for example, invested 100% in stocks for the long term, and in a lot of cases, you know, I recommend that, you know, if you're in your 20s and your 30s, you know, investing 100% in stocks for the long term so you can maximize that growth and compounding potential. Even though stocks are really expensive, right now as I'm making this video, I personally believe that the stock markets, there's going to be a correction in the stock market in the next probably year, year and a half, and the stock market will probably drop maybe 20, 30%. But you want to keep buying stocks due to dollar cost averaging. So I actually think that for a lot of investors, stock prices going down will be a really good thing. So you might lose money in the short term, but it's important to remember with stock investing, you actually only lose money when you sell the stock, not when it, you know, you own it and it just goes down in value. And so you only actually lose money when you sell and that loss is realized. And so if your portfolio goes down 20%, you really didn't lose 20% of your money. You only lose 20% of your money if you were able to, if you were selling that stock. And so investing over the long term, I actually think the stock market going down is going to be good for investors, because there's going to be more values, there's going to be lower prices. And so from my opinion, you should just keep investing in the stock market, keep buying it, even though it's probably going to go down in the next year. There's no way to time the market, and then keep buying it back, you know, on the upswing. And over time, you're going to buy high and you're going to buy low, but the compounding impact of that in investing in stocks over the long term is going to be really positive. And so you have to think about stocks over the past 100 years. The average inflation and dividends adjusted return for stocks is 7.2% compounding per year. And so that means that on average, even though the stock market goes up and down, up and down, up and down, over the long term, it's always been up approximately 7.2% per year. And when 7.2% is actually a pretty incredible return. And there's something called the rule of 72, which is basically you take the number 72 and you divide it by the growth rate, so in this case 7.2%, to figure out how often your money is going to double. So in the stock market over the long term, your money should double at least every 10 years. And so over time, that compounding impact, your money just keeps growing and growing and growing, you know, as, you know, $100,000 becomes $200,000, becomes $400,000, becomes $800,000. And as you're adding money to it, it actually accelerates the rate of growth. And that's really the key, and one of the keys to fast tracking financial freedom, is that you're trying to invest as much as early and as often as you can to increase the rate of compounding and the rate of growth. But the way to take advantage of that is to, you know, invest in stocks for the long term and to have a pretty aggressive strategy. I'm still invested 100% in stocks because I actually don't live off my investments. And so my money is invested for the long term, and I'm 100% bullish on the U.S. economy, you know, over the next, you know, 20, 30 years. Number three, diversification. You know, I've talked about this before. You know, if you're a beginning investor, if you're a long, you know, a more experienced investor, you know, getting most of your money in long-term, you know, total stock market index funds like Vanguard's VTSAX, you know, funds that are incredibly diversified, that own really a portion of almost all the stocks in the U.S. stock market. And so you're able to take advantage of, as I said, that 7.2% annual compounding growth over time. And you know, you're well diversified. So if one business goes out of business, or if some company goes under, or some does really well over term, over the time, the long-term impact of investing in the total stock market, the compounding is 7.2%, which is an incredible rate of compounding growth over time. So there's a lot of ways to invest in stocks. You can buy individual stocks, but really without a doubt, the best way to invest is by buying mutual funds or ETFs. Mutual funds and ETFs are very similar. They're basically just like a collection of stocks based around a particular theme. But in a vast majority of cases, you know, I recommend buying long-term total stock market index funds. Schwab has a low-cost one. Fidelity has a low-cost one. Vanguard has a low-cost one. And then you're able to diversify naturally just by buying, you know, a low-cost mutual fund or ETF. In almost all cases, ETFs are the better choice, just because you can buy and sell them whenever you want to. Mutual funds are actually priced at the end of the day. And so, you know, buying ETFs gives you a little bit more flexibility. The cost tend to be pretty similar between the two, but I almost always invest in ETFs. Number four, when should you buy individual stocks? So I've always been a fan of individual stocks just because you know, index funds to me are really boring. The nice thing about index funds is that, you know, when you invest in an index fund, you're like beating 90% of all investors, because most stock investors are actually pretty dumb. And so they get emotional, like I said at the beginning of the event, and, you know, they buy high, they sell low, they get really emotional. And actually, the entire stock market is really based around, you know, it's people's emotions, it's people buying and selling stock. And so, I actually recommend you put most of your money in these long-term total stock index funds, but I've always taken about 5 to 10% of my own net worth and bought individual stocks just for companies that I believe in. It, you know, keeps you interested and it can be fun, and B, it gives you a little more upside. So interestingly, because I've invested in a few individual companies over the past 8 years, I've actually beaten the S&P. So I've beaten the US stock market every single year the past 8 years. And that's something, the only way I've been able to do it is because I invested in the total stock market, and then I invested in some individual companies that have naturally beat and gotten higher returns than the stock market. So, you know, I was an early investor in Facebook. I was, you know, I invested in Amazon. I bought some Netflix, some Google, some Starbucks. I saw, you know, I have a little portfolio, little meaning I have a few stocks that I invest in. And my, for example, my Amazon stake, you know, has grown considerably. I think if you're going to, you know, I don't give out stock investing advice lightly. And I think if there's one company to invest in for the future, it's definitely Amazon. I think in the next year or 2 years, Amazon's actually going to get to a point where either A, they're going to split themselves into five companies, at which point their stock value is going to go up a lot, or B, the government's going to force them to, just because they're becoming such a large company. And so Amazon, I think, you know, over the long term is probably the best individual stock that you can buy. And I'm actually still buying Amazon. But remember, you should be putting most of your money in your 401k and in a Roth IRA. And in a Roth IRA, you can actually buy stocks, but I don't necessarily recommend it. I do a lot of my stock buying in my SEP IRA, which is basically an employment plan for myself. And so I buy and sell stocks within that, because actually whenever I sell a stock in there, I don't have to pay taxes on it because it's an IRA. You only have to pay taxes on the money in an SEP when you take it out. But you know, a vast majority of your money should be in low cost, diversified total stock market index funds. And then, you know, take a little bit of your money and you can buy individual stocks that you believe in. Also because it keeps you interested in investing, and it can be a lot of fun, but never really more than 5 to 10% of your entire portfolio in individual stocks. So this chart here, I know it might be pretty small on your screen. I mean, you can obviously take a screenshot of it. Like I said, this PDF is going to be available for download under the video, probably by tomorrow, maybe by Saturday, within the members area. So you can check back there and download this PDF. What this is, I built this. This is actually in my financial freedom book, so you get to see it early. It's basically how you should invest based on the amount of risk that you want to take. So on the far left side, if you want to be 100% in stocks and you have access to a total stock market fund, you know, I have a little description about what a total stock market fund is, and that you should be 100% invested. And then actually at the top there, it goes from left to right, from riskiest to least risky, all the way over to the far side, which is if you want to put 60% of your portfolio into stocks and 40% into bonds. And so, I can talk about bonds really quickly here. I don't have a specific slide on it. I don't invest in bonds, but bonds are, you know, they're basically debt that you're buying. And it can actually be a pretty conservative way to invest. If you buy high quality bonds, you know, that are issued by like the US government or by local governments, you can use bonds as a way to, you know, diversify and hedge your portfolio. So a lot of early retirees, for example, once they actually retire, they switch their portfolio maybe from 100% stocks and 90% or 90% and 10%, 90% stocks and 10% bonds. They typically switch it to, you know, a 60-40 ratio. And so when you do that, the 40% bonds are really a fixed income investment. And so you know pretty much what return you're going to get. And the reason why is a government or a local government, you know, issues an amount of debt that you buy. You know, you buy debt through bond mutual funds. So you're not going individually to a government. I don't recommend buying bonds directly. That's so old school. You just buy like a total bond market fund. And so you're buying the debt, and then the person who owes the debt, the government that owns the debt, guarantees a certain rate of return. And so there's a lot of early retirees, a lot of people who are financially independent, who actually live entirely off the money that their bonds generate. And so they've built their portfolio, and so they know every year they're getting a 3 or 4% maybe return on their money from the bonds, and they just live off of that. And then they leave 60% of their money in the stock market just to keep growing. Occasionally, you know, they might take a little bit of money out of the stock market, but that 60% is meant to be a growth engine, and the 40% of bonds. And so you really should only be thinking about investing in bonds, you know, in my opinion, if you're like 5 years or less from retiring or wanting to live off your investments for the rest of your life. In other instances, you should stay heavily invested in stocks, you know, for the long term. For the short term, bonds can actually be a pretty good investment. You can invest in bonds that keep up with the rate of inflation, which is, you know, every year the cost of things continue to get more expensive. And so actually, if you just keep your money in cash in a savings account, you lose money over time because inflation goes up. And so the value of a dollar actually decreases over time due to inflation. But if you invest in some bond funds, you can actually insulate yourself against inflation and, you know, get a consistent return. So, you know, if you need the money in the next 5 years, investing in like a total bond fund, you know, it's probably going to give you a higher return than an online savings account. And as I mentioned, in most cases, you don't get penalized when you take out the money. One thing I did want to talk about are target date funds, because that's what, you know, if you have a 401k, a lot of companies have these. And if they default you into an investment, they typically default you into what's known as a target date fund. And target date funds are basically, you know, a lot of them have a year associated with them. So it's like the 2050 fund. And the idea is that, you know, you estimate the date that you want to retire, and then you invest in this fund, and it actually adjusts your asset allocation, which is your percentage of stocks and bonds, as you get closer to retirement. And a lot of these target funds, I mean, they're okay, you know, they're simple. But in my opinion, a lot of them are, you know, just too expensive. They charge too high of fees. And, you know, some of them have just kind of wonky, weird investments within them. And so that's the reason I put together this chart, because You know, if you do have access to these other funds, you know, you should just build your portfolio. There's no fund. If you don't have access in your 401k to a total stock market fund or an S&P 500 fund, then investing in a target date fund, which like a vast majority of 401k plans have, you know, that's fine. It's better. It's better than nothing. But, you know, a lot of, you know, personal finance, you know, experts or financial advisors, they recommend that you keep your age in bonds. And so they would say, you know, I'm 33 right now. And so they would say I should have 60%, you know, 67% of my money in stocks and 33% of my money in bonds. But I think that, you know, that's way too conservative. And there's no way, especially as you're making more money, as you're investing for the long term, there's no reason to keep your age in bonds. I think it's ridiculous. It's too conservative, especially if you're investing for the long term. So like I said, this PDF will be available, you know, for download under the video in the members area in the next couple of days. So now I wanted to talk about real estate. So a vast majority of my money, of you know, any early retirees' money, is going to be invested in stocks, bonds, and real estate. And the biggest reason is just they're much more predictable in how they behave. And when investments are much more predictable in how they behave, you can actually mitigate your risk. And so the whole idea of investing is that you want to maximize your return while minimizing your risk. And so that's one of the reasons, you know, most people invest in stock. Not most people, but you should be investing in stock. I don't invest in bonds, but you can, and then real estate. And so the big question a lot of people ask is are stocks or real estate a better investment? I invest in both of them because they behave entirely differently. I don't recommend going all in on either. And if you can, investing in both is a really wise decision. But actually over time, real estate has better inflation adjusted returns than stocks. And there's a number of different reasons for this, but over the long term, you know, you can build real estate portfolios that generate much better consistent is the key here, returns than the stock market does over the short term. And what I mean by that, like the stock market hasn't done much this year, you know, it's up maybe 1 or 2%. And, you know, if you had an investment property and, you know, you're managing it well, you know, your investment property might be able to consistently return based on the cost of your mortgage and the cost of, you know, either a renter, you know, it could return a higher percentage than stocks. So a lot of real estate investors, I know, you know, they're getting about 7%. Return on their money, having it invested in real estate. So that's obviously higher than 1 or 2%. But the thing is, next year, you know, they'll probably get 7, maybe 8% return on their properties, but maybe stocks will be up 30%. Who knows? But over the long haul, in most real estate markets in the United States, actually real estate outperforms, you know, stocks, you know, almost always in the short term. With that being said, you know, as I mentioned, you know, any gain or any loss is only realized when you actually sell the investment, not when you hold it. One of the reasons I really like real estate, you know, I call it the win-win-win, is because, you know, you're able to leverage other people's money, you know, bank's money in this case. Like if you have, say, you know, $10,000 to invest, you can go and put that money in the stock market, but you're only going to be able to get $10,000 worth of stock. Whereas if you go and put down a 10% down payment on a home, and then the other 90% is covered by the bank, you're using that 10% to not just, you know, you're not buying $10,000 worth of stock, you're buying, you know, $100,000 worth of property. And yeah, you're taking out a mortgage for it, but that $100,000 of property, you know, you're only using 10% of your money, or $10,000 of your money. And so that real estate, actually you have more money that can grow because you're leveraging someone else's money, as opposed to, you know, you put $10,000 in the stock market, you can't all of a sudden, you know, it's not going to turn into $100,000, you know, very quickly. And so that's why a lot of the best real estate investors, they're able to leverage the bank's money, because at the end of the day, the bank loans money and they want to they want a consistent return on their money. You know, that's your mortgage rate. But what happens to the property, how much it goes up in value, actually all that upside benefits you, the investor, not the bank. And so if your property goes up $100,000 in value, so say you put down $10,000 to buy a $100,000 property, and then in the next 2 years, that property is worth $200,000. All of a sudden, you've made $100,000 on your $10,000 investment. So your investment's increased 10x, whereas that would be completely impossible when investing in the stock market. So that's one of the reasons why real estate is so amazing. There's also, you know, you can buy a property with the bank's money, and then over time that property can go up in value. You can take something that's known as a depreciation deduction. I'm not going to dig into that here, but it's definitely worth investigating. The government on your on rental properties that you buy, you're able to deduct depreciation, which is like the what they believe to be the decrease in value, you know, from the apartment wearing out and things wearing out. You could also, if you have a rental and you manage your properties like under an LLC, you can take a lot of deductions. You know, you can deduct home repairs, you can deduct a lot of expenses from your taxes, just like you can having a side business. And then, you know, the idea is like you can buy a property and have, you know, have a renter that covers the cost of the mortgage, and over time, both the property goes up in value and rent costs continue to go up. And so you're able to charge more money as you're paying down the mortgage. And so say in 10 or 20 years, you have a property that's worth $1 million and it's generating $3,000, $4,000 a month in rental income, and you don't owe any money on it. So you've used someone else's money to pay down the debt while the property went up in value. And then over time, you know, the portfolio of your real estate grows. So actually, I think that real estate investing is probably the fastest way to get to financial independence. If you can do it right. I know, you know, it can be scary taking on debt. It's pretty easy to make bad decisions when it comes to real estate investing, but the more you know, the more you educate yourself, the easier it gets to make better real estate investing decisions. Just like anything with money, you know, the more time you spend with it, the better you're going to get. Number three, you know, you've probably heard about house hacking before. Just the simple idea of, you know, I think a lot of people wait too long to buy a house, with the caveat that a lot of real estate markets are very expensive right now. And so, you know, investing in a home in Denver or Seattle or, you know, Dallas or Los Angeles or New York, you know, it can be very expensive. So those markets are going down in value. But, you know, a lot of people, I think, wait on the sidelines with real estate for too long when you could buy, you know, a 2 or 3 bedroom home, rent out the other 2 rooms to offset the cost of your mortgage. And all of a sudden you own a home that's going up in value over the long term, and you have a couple renters that cover part of the cost of your mortgage. And in some markets, if the costs work out, you know, the cap rates, you know, work out, then you can actually get your renters to cover, you know, the entire cost of the mortgage, and you can live for free. So I know, you know, a number of people who are doing that. And then one trend I'm seeing is, you know, a lot of younger people, or some younger people, are actually pooling their money together and buying a home. And so, you know, you might have $10,000 and your friend might have $10,000. And so you put the down payment, you actually buy a house with your friend, rent out the couple extra rooms, and you do house hacking together, just to cover the cost of, you know, your mortgage to grow your home value. I mean, your first home, your second home, your first investment property, you know, those can be some of the best investment decisions you're gonna make in your life, because that's kind of the fastest way you can go in investing, from maybe having $10,000 to $100,000 or $200,000. You know, your money's gonna grow faster in that case in real estate. At the same time, you know, there are certain markets, as I said, that are going to go down in value. And so if the property doesn't go up, you know, you could maybe lose money. There's ways to mitigate that. And the one thing about real estate too, is that it's the only investment that you can actually live in. So you can't live in stocks. You know, there's definitely hassles in being a landlord and having renters, but, you know, in most cases you can, you know, get a property manager for, a portion of the monthly rent, typically 7 to 10%, to, you know, maintain the property, to screen tenants. And the one thing is, actually, real estate can give you a lot of flexibility because who your tenants are. And so, you know, you could pick maybe an older couple, or someone who's going to do less damage on your home. If you're renting apartments to college kids, you just have to, you know, factor in, you know, a premium for, replacing things. And in any real estate investment, you always want to budget at least 20 to 25% of the rent. So, to cover expenses, things like repairs, taxes, tends to be a good rule. And then finally, finding the perfect rental property, the 1% rule is a pretty good starting point. It's basically like, you know, look at how much the apartment or the home typically rents for. And, you know, you don't want to, it's not going to make sense for, as an investment, if that rent is more than 1% of the purchase price. So for example, if it rents for $2,000, but the apartment is, $250,000, that's more than 1%. And so that 1% rule in a lot of markets tends to be a good starting point. If you're just evaluating properties, as I mentioned, you got to be careful in terms of buying rental properties, and you should always be more conservative than not, just because, you know, there's some months where maybe you won't have tenants, or, you know, you might need to replace a refrigerator or an appliance. And so being a little bit more conservative is always the way to go with real estate. But as I said, learning about real estate, doubling down on it, you know, over the next 5-10 years, if you do it right, you know, you can reach FI incredibly quickly. But as I said, you know, I invest in both stocks and real estate. I like them both for different reasons. I don't like having all of my eggs in one basket, but, you know, almost all of my money is in stock and in real estate. I strongly recommend both of them. Learning as much as you can about them. And then last but not least, everything else. You know, I've had a few questions of what else do you invest in besides real estate. You know, some of you know I have some Bitcoin and Ethereum still. I don't recommend that you invest in cryptocurrencies at all. There's a number of reasons for that. I do believe in the blockchain technology, but cryptocurrencies not being backed by anything has always worried me. My investment in Bitcoin, you know, I just got lucky and just was able to invest in the idea, you know, pretty early on. But I don't recommend investing in cryptocurrencies. I definitely don't recommend day trading in cryptocurrencies. I got a question from a reader the other day about that. Number two, art and collectibles. I'm actually a fan of art. I've got a couple of, my friends did some paintings, and, I've bought a couple of them. This is one of those things with art. You can't rely on it. You can't count on it. I don't view any art piece that I've bought as an investment. If you're going to buy art, just buy something you enjoy, something you like. Very, very hard to predict, almost impossible to predict what's going to go up in value over time. So I wouldn't even try. Number three, someone else's vision. Far too many people invest money in their friend's company or their friend's vision. Almost always you should invest in your own vision and yourself instead of your friend's vision. Good ideas, as you know, are a dime a dozen, and a good idea doesn't mean anything. It's all about execution and timing the market. And, you know, all of you who've gone through, you know, the Side Hustle Framework course, you know, that, you know, it's important to analyze market demand, you know, for yourself. Far too many people I know have, you know, write to me, hey, you know, I put $20,000 into my friend's app or my friend's vision, and then they just end up losing the money. So almost 99%. Probably 100% of the time, I don't recommend investing in your friends or your family's businesses. You know, you want to own your money, and you want to increase the growth potential on your own. I wouldn't distribute the risk. Investing in anyone's business is incredibly risky. And then finally, just investing in yourself. You know, we've talked quite a bit about this. Typically, every year, I'll take, 1 to 2% of the money that I've made and invested in myself in some way, you know, whether it's a course or a retreat or a conference, or buying books. You know, I'm always trying to learn in that sense. And then if you've got a vision, you know, we talked about this in the Side Hustle course, you got to be careful about how much you invest in yourself and in your vision. You know, if you have to invest $10,000, $20,000 to start a side hustle, you know, you shouldn't start a side hustle where you have to invest that much money. You only should invest that money if you already have a proof of concept, if you're already getting clients and making money, and if you very clearly see an opportunity where specifically spending $5,000, $10,000, $20,000 is going to grow your revenue over the long term. Too many people, you know, take $20,000, $30,000 and invest it in a business idea without having any proof of concept or without analyzing, you know, things like the market demand like we did in the side hustle framework. So that's what I invest in. That's what I recommend investing in. A lot of wealth building is pretty simple. You know, as I said, minimizing the impact of taxes, staying consistent, investing in, you know, as much as you can. And like I said, stock and real estate are both very expensive now, but over the long term, I believe strongly in both of them, and in diversifying in both if you can. And so that is it for the Best Investing Strategies webinar. Let me know if you have any questions on the right side, and I will dive into a few that were posted in the forum. Let me get here. And if you ever have any questions, I just opened that AMA, the Ask Me Anything forum, where just during the week, if you have any questions on anything, you know, for me, you can throw it in there. You know, there's a side hustling forum now, and you can go in there and drop questions. I'm going to be hopping in there two or three times a week to answer all the questions in between, you know, live events. Let's see. So Tyler asks, how does your investing strategy change, if at all, as your net worth grows? For example, a $50,000 house in a Class C neighborhood might appeal to an early investor, even though there might be some stress and work involved, while I would think a multimillionaire would pass it up and choose to invest in index funds instead because of the low stress maintenance of that investment, given $50,000 is a smaller part of their portfolio. That's a really good question. Your investing strategy will change, A, as you have more money, and then B, as you learn more about investing, and then C, as you change. And so the things and how I like investing now is a little bit different than how I invested when I was younger. And so right now, you know, I was really into real estate for a number of years. I enjoyed, you know, buying properties. I enjoyed investing. I enjoyed that whole process. Right now in my life, you know, I have a lot going on. I've got the book coming out. I'm moving to New York City. I decided not to buy a home in New York City right now because A, the cost of real estate is going down, and that's very easy to see. It actually dropped about 5% while I was looking. And then the other thing is I really don't want to hassle, like I'm sitting right now in one of my Chicago places. I really don't want to hassle with being a landlord with right now where I'm at in my life. The properties that I own, they've gone up in value. I'm going to sell them, knock on wood, quickly and use that money to your point, Tyler, to invest in something that's a little bit easier. You know, I'm going to put that money actually probably in index funds and Amazon stock and not buy another property for a while just because I don't want to deal with the hassle of being a landlord. So it depends on how much money you have, what risk you think there is, and where you're at in your life, because real estate investing is fun. And, you know, if you've got $10,000, $20,000 to invest in it and you've got a pretty small portfolio and you're willing to, you know, to your point, you know, invest the money in doing repairs and fixing the house up and growing that, you know, that can be a really wise decision. And, you know, you're willing to put a little more sweat in. Whereas, you know, being a multimillionaire, having a lot of money, you know, it's just not worth your time to go in, you know, and buy a $50,000 house and, you know, try to flip it for $20,000, unless you're building a flipping business and you're doing that just consistently over time. So that's a really good question. You know, your investing strategy is going to change as you change. And sometimes you're going to be more bullish and be more into it. And other times, you know, you're just going to want to invest in stocks and just coast. From Zach, are you looking into other investment opportunities besides real estate, index funds, and individual stocks? No, not currently. I am investing some money in millennial money. So I'm hiring some writers who are going to write some content on the back end just so I could take advantage and grow some traffic in some very specific areas. So I am investing in millennial money, putting some money back. So that's the other focus that I have beyond real estate, index funds and stocks. My book comes out, as you know, in February, and I'm investing money in doing a book tour and doing some marketing for it. And so that's where other money for me is going in the short term. So it's really just investing in myself. You can also crowdfund real estate. We didn't talk much about that, but if it's a little too early for you to buy a property and you want to diversify with real estate, investing, with websites like Fundrise, and others can be a good decision if you want to diversify your portfolio a little bit. But like I said, you should be putting as much money as you can, up to $18,500 in your 401k, and, 5,500 in one of your IRAs. So that's $24,000. You should be investing in those before you're thinking about investing in anything else, unless it's a property. And like I said, maybe 1-2% of your earnings in yourself. Anna asks, any suggestions for investing your emergency fund monies? Yeah, that's a good question. I've always kept my emergency fund in an IRA. So I always considered my Roth IRA as my emergency fund, just because I could always take that money out if I needed it. Like I said, I never keep more than $10,000 or $12,000 in cash accessible. I like to keep as much money of my invested as possible. There's a reason I do that. So I technically don't have an emergency fund because, I have enough credit cards with high enough balances that I could, if I had an emergency, I needed $20,000 or $30,000, I could put it on my credit card. And then, I know that the next month I could take money from somewhere, I could sell an investment, I could make more money, to pay down that $20,000, $30,000 emergency. And so, like I said, it depends on how much money you have. If it helps you sleep at night, having 3 to 6 months of cash sitting in an online savings account like Ally, it can be a wise decision. But other than that, I think that, you should be investing your money for the long term. And like I said, I always viewed my Roth IRA as an emergency fund and that I could take money out of if I really, really needed it. Kristen, I remember reading on your blog a list of funds that you invest in. Would you still recommend all of those same ones? Yeah, I am much more streamlined than when I wrote that article. And so I was, investing in an international stock fund. There were a few others. Right now, a lot of my money is in VTSAX. That's the Vanguard Total Stock Market Admiral Fund, very low cost mutual fund. A lot of my money is in that. And then I have some money in individual stocks. So I'm all about simplification. So typically you want to have maybe, one, two or three fund portfolio. You don't need to be buying all these different ETFs and all these different mutual funds. And so, I still recommend those funds, but I've definitely simplified it pretty considerably since then. When you simplify it, A, it's easier to manage, and B, I think you don't need to have a ton of different funds. Franklin, does it matter to you how physically close you are to a real estate market if you have a managing company? Yeah, that actually, I think it does. And so if I was staying in Chicago, for example, I probably would be more open to, renting my real estate. The fact that I'm going to be in New York, I don't know any, managing companies in Chicago. If I had like a friend that owned one that I really trusted, I might consider it. I think proximity is important. But at the end of the day, what matters is the tenant. And so if you can find a really low risk tenant, like, someone who's a little bit older or someone who probably will live in the place for a long time, so it's really low risk, you get a good tenant that's going to stay, in your place 7 to 10 years, then it doesn't even matter where you live, and you might not even need a management company. So that really depends on the type of tenant, the type of market. You know, obviously, if you're living in a college town and you're renting your place to college kids, you know, it's a whole nother animal than, you know, having a nice place and finding someone that wants to live there for the long term. So any other last questions? Let me see. Check here real quick. All right, I think, oh, wait. Got a, in your opinion, what is the ideal asset allocation for the different stages of life, wealth building versus wealth preservation? I answered that, but we'll answer it again. The wealth building, 100% stocks. Once you get into the wealth preservation, maybe an 80-20 stock bond split or 60-40 stock bond fit. Angela, what do you think about brokerage accounts? So brokerage accounts where you're selling individual stocks. As I mentioned, I think you should put most of your money in 401ks and IRAs, and then maybe a little bit of your money in a brokerage account. You know, I buy actually all of my stocks, you know, through a Vanguard. So I use their brokerage account. You know, a lot of them are low cost nowadays, you know, the Fidelities, the E-Trades of the world. But as I said, you know, only putting 5 to 10% of your investment balance in individual stocks within a brokerage account is typically what I recommend. So hey everyone, hope you enjoyed the investing strategy webinar. As I mentioned, I'm going to post this in the forum in the next couple of days, and you can ask questions there. And thanks for tuning in. I will see you soon.